into the darkness. You're the only right among the wrong. You're the only hope among the chaos. You are the voice that calls me on. Louder than every lie, my sword in every fight, the truth will chase away the night. Your name is power over darkness, freedom for the captives, mercy for the broken and the hopeless. Your name is faithful in the battle, glory in the struggle.
Night, you can light it up.
listen to a prayer tonight over our nation, over our cities. Come awaken your people. Come awaken your city. Oh God, every Bible, pour it out, pour it out. Every stronghold will crumble. Hear the chains hit the ground. Oh God, every Bible, pour it out, pour.
across it all. There's no broken body you can't raise, no soul that you can't save. All things are possible, things are possible.
I am all for you.
precious to you. The Lord turn his face toward you and give you peace. Amen. 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 Amen.
Lord bless you and keep you. Make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord
Good morning. Welcome to Emmanuel Church this morning. My name's Christine. I'm the curate here, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to tune in and worship with us this morning. It's my pleasure to welcome back James and Amelia after their wedding last week. It is great to have you back with us. And also my pleasure to welcome Matt Bird, who has joined the staff team this week as our new worship pastor. I just want to let you know what's happening today. So after this service at 11:30, we are going to be having our coffee time together via Zoom. Then this afternoon, James is hosting another HMS manual, which is happening at 2, 2:30 and 3. And then at 5:30 this evening, we're having another Zoom service together. And Richard's going to be speaking about, does God care about the environment? And also just to let you know that we are going to be reviewing this week everything that we're doing, from our online stuff to our in-person to all our events, and we will let you know the plans for the future. Let's pray together. Father God, we want to pray for James and Amelia. Thank you for their wedding. We pray blessing upon their marriage as they settle into life together. Lord, we lift up Matt to you and ask that you would be with him and help him to settle into life here in Northwood as well, that he may be a blessing to us in his ministry and that we may be a blessing to him. And Lord, we want to lift up all of the friends and family of Sylvia as they are grieving at the moment. Pray your presence would be with them, that you would comfort them, that you would guide them, that your peace would rest with them. And we pray that you would be with all those present at the funeral this week on Wednesday. Lord, we look to you afresh this morning. We come to worship you. We come to be with you. We come to glorify you and to give you the praise that is due your name. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not. Shame.
Johnny's now going to bring us our Bible reading, and he'll be followed by Dave, who's going to bring us our talk this morning.
Today's Bible reading comes from the Gospel of John, chapter 10, verses 1 to 16. Very truly I tell you, Pharisees, anyone who does not enter the sheepfold by the gate, but climbs in by some other way, is a thief and a robber. The one who enters by the gate is the shepherd of the sheep. The gatekeeper opens the gate for him, and the sheep listen to his voice. He calls his own sheep by name and leads them out. When he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them, and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. But they will never follow a stranger. In fact, they will run away from him because they do not recognize a stranger's voice. Jesus used this figure of speech, but the Pharisees did not understand what he was telling them. Therefore, Jesus said again, "Very truly I tell you, I am the gate for the sheep. All who have come before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep have not listened to them. I am the gate. Whoever enters through me will be saved. They will come in and go out and find pasture. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep. The hired hand is not the shepherd and does not own the sheep. So when he sees the wolf coming, he abandons the sheep and runs away. Then the wolf attacks the flock and scatters it. The man runs away because he is a hired hand and cares nothing for the sheep. I am the good shepherd. I know my sheep and my sheep know me. Just as the Father knows me and I know the Father. And I lay down my life for the sheep. I have other sheep that are not of the sheepfold. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice. And there shall be one flock and one shepherd.
Thanks, Johnny, for our reading, and good morning, everybody. Great to be with you today. Well, this parable of Jesus starts with a picture that would be familiar to those that Jesus spoke to, but is quite unfamiliar for many of us, even for me, who was brought up in the Lake District with plenty of sheep around. It's about a Middle Eastern context. So first of all, we're going to look a little bit at the background, and then we'll come on to thinking about Jesus and what he means by saying, I am the gate. We're going to look at, first of all, the shepherd and the sheep in the Middle East, then the context around this passage in John chapter 9 and 10, and then thinking about shepherd and sheep in the Jewish scriptures, just to help us see what's really going on. So first of all, shepherd and sheep in the Middle East. This is not a picture of a hill farm isolated with hundreds of sheep in the open country, but more of a village context. Every home probably had a few sheep gathered in a courtyard. Better translation than sheepfold, which gives that idea of a field out in the middle of nowhere. Those courtyards were between the houses, and that's where the sheep stayed overnight. I do remember from a Middle East trip that in the villages, the goats or sheep or hens would be running around in this space among the outhouses and even into the cooking area. The entrance into the courtyard was protected by a gate or a door with a gatekeeper controlling who could come in. Each family couldn't spare someone to be with their few sheep all day, so in the morning, a shepherd, perhaps a son from one of the families, or a hired hand, gathered the sheep from each courtyard to take to the fields. Each gatekeeper opened up the gate to the shepherd, recognising him, of course, and the sheep, also recognising him, follow him out. They're not driven. Sheep are not the cleverest animals, but they know that following this familiar person always results in lunch. He daily leads them to their pasture. The shepherd looked after the sheep in the old open fields through the day and brought them back to the security of the courtyard at the end of the day. Let's look next a little bit at the context around John chapters 9 and 10. Who is this actually being told to? Well, to the Pharisees, and somewhat pointedly, because they've been involved in what has just gone before. In John chapter 9, we see blindness and sight. John brings us back to the healing of a blind man at the end of our section today in John chapter 10. So he's connecting it in with chapter 9, where Jesus healed a man born blind so that he could see. He also saw with the eyes of his heart who Jesus was, believed in him, and responded in worship. The Pharisees saw physically, but were blind to who Jesus was. Tom Wright spells out what they're struggling with. Is Jesus from God or not? Is he a prophet or not? Is he the Messiah or not? The Son of Man, whom God will set as judge over the world? Well, unsurprisingly, they don't understand Jesus' parable in verses 1 to 5 of our passage today. So he explains it further, and that goes right through to verse 30 beyond where we read today. Jesus' images, though, were familiar to them, from life in their villages, which we've already talked about, but also from their scripture. The shepherd and the sheep come up many times in the Old Testament. The shepherd was often speaking about God, or speaking about the King, his anointed one, particularly the Messiah. Psalm 23 comes to mind. The Lord is my shepherd, And here, of course, Jesus is the Good Shepherd. And the themes there are like the ones that Jesus speaks of today, about the way that he protects and provides and gives eternal security to those who are his. But shepherd is also mentioned in terms of the false shepherd or thief who gets among the sheep with a bad motive of selfish gain, of power, and not of care. Jesus says, "All who came before me were thieves and robbers." Well, the Pharisees knew, of course, of the false prophets and wicked kings of their scriptures, and also of God's promise to send a just shepherd like David, the Messiah, or to shepherd the flock himself as their saviour. You can find some of these references in places like Ezekiel chapter 34 or the beginning of Jeremiah 23. In the person of Jesus, the divine Messiah, and God the Son, God does both. Now, the Pharisees that Jesus is speaking to sought to lead the sheep, God's people, Israel, in following God's law. And right here, the Jews, who are referred to in chapter 9, mistreated the man born blind. They should probably understand that they're being addressed as false shepherds. And just as Jesus said, the blind man and many others of the sheep didn't listen to them. Well, as I've kind of inferred already, the sheep are Israel, God's people. So with this background, Jesus reveals who he is and his work to those Pharisees of 2,000 years ago and to anyone wanting to know more of him today. They didn't understand it and weren't in agreement as to who Jesus was. Some said, "He's out of his mind." Others, "He's the one who opened the eyes of the blind man." What about you? Well, the passage contains two of Jesus' I am statements. "I am the good shepherd," verses 11 and 14, which Kate talked about 2 weeks ago. And "I am the gate," verses 7 and again verse 9, which we're going to focus on today. Jesus says, "I am the gate." A Middle Eastern shepherd might sleep in the entrance to the fold, almost literally being the door, the gate. He watched over the coming in and going out of the sheep. Jesus is saying that he does just as God himself has promised to do in Psalm 121. "The Lord will keep you from all harm. He will watch over your life. The Lord will watch over your coming and your going, both now and forevermore." So let's look more into this coming and going. The sheep come in and go out. So first of all, the coming in. This is focused upon protection. As the sheep come in at night, they come into that safe place where the shepherd himself is the door or the gate. Now, God protects us in many ways, guarding our health, our homes, our loved ones. And we probably all have stories to tell of how he's done it. I can think of times when I've been out of my depth in the sea and really felt God's protection. Or times when I've been sliding down a snowy mountain and stopped just short of a crevasse. Or another time on the cliffs. That time was a trip that I'd gone on to pray and meet people in North Africa. And we stopped one night and woke up the next morning to find we were on a stunning beach. There was a really nice looking cliff just at the edge of the beach. And I walked over to it and thought, this looks too good to miss. I started to climb my way up it. It looked like it got a little bit easier on the way up as it got higher. So I thought, it's going to be all right. When I reached about 2/3 of the way up, I began to find that the rocks were getting looser and looser. And it was too far to jump down. And I certainly didn't have the energy to try and climb down where I'd come. By God's grace, I managed to find my way up that last bit and reach the top and then find a way to clamber down at the back of the cliff so I didn't have to climb back down again. But I really sensed God protected me in something quite foolish that I'd done. I hope I've learned a little bit since then. Now, sometimes, of course, there are accidents. Sometimes our health doesn't recover. Sometimes bad things happen to those that we love. But God does promise an eternal security, here described as salvation. For those who enter through Jesus will be saved. Jesus says a little bit later in John's Gospel, "No one comes to the Father except through me." Except through me. Jesus is unique. He's the Saviour who laid down his life to rescue the sheep. As the owner, given the flock by his Father, that's mentioned in verse 29, he will not run from the danger that faces the flock. He will face death head on. And with God's own authority, he took up his life again, winning the victory over death. He was raised to life, giving us hope of new life and eternal life. We enter this new eternal life through trust in the person of Jesus, receiving forgiveness through what he has done and being restored into relationship with God our Father. He says, also a little bit later, just below our passage, "I give them eternal life. They shall never perish. No one will snatch them out of my hand." This is the rock solid eternal security for those who put their trust in Jesus. We come into the place of protection through Jesus, who says, "I am the gate." Next, the going out. This focuses in on provision. Maybe you find it strange that it mentions going out, but this is not about the sheep leaving the shepherd. It's about going out with him. Everyone knows the sheep can't stay in the courtyard all day. They'd starve. In the daytime, they need to go out to find pasture. Coming into the fold, salvation, is only a part of the Christian life. The sheep go out to find pasture, and they find it because they listen to the shepherd's voice. They follow him out to the pasture. It's in the coming in and the going out that Jesus promises fullness of life. Jesus says, "The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full." Jesus gives abundant life to all who put their trust in him, who listen to his voice and follow him. Others may promise full life, material things, that triplet, money, sex, and power. But those things make empty promises. They don't bring lasting contentment. In fact, they do just what Jesus says here. They harm us, potentially killing spiritual life and robbing us of what God wants for us in Jesus. Jesus says, when he has brought out all his own, he goes on ahead of them and his sheep follow him because they know his voice. Following Jesus, putting into practice his teaching, what he speaks and what he models, is the way to this abundant life. He's the one who said, "I am the way." It's a way of love, love for God and love for others, which is reflected in obedience to his commands and following him safely out to the pasture and back to the fold. Hearing his voice can mean more, though, than the general living the Christian life. It can also mean the specifics of hearing his guidance for our own lives and situations and for those around us. Last Sunday at our 5:30 p.m. service, we looked at this passage and the promise that it contains, "My sheep hear my voice." we took some time to think about and grow in faith for hearing from God, and then took some time to listen, to tune into him, and found that God speaks. This is something not just for a few, but for all of us, for every sheep, because his sheep hear his voice. And it comes out of knowing him, knowing Jesus. Not just knowing about him. Jesus says, I know my sheep, and my sheep know me. Now, one thing not many know about me is that once police removed me from a train in the Middle East. Don't worry, I hadn't done anything too awful. I was apparently on what had at that time of the day just become a carriage for women only. I was there with Gabriela, and the police ushered me and all of the other men in the carriage out onto the platform. And I just managed to convey to Gabriela, I'll see you at the next station. They gathered me and the other local Arabic speakers on the platform. I didn't speak much Arabic at that stage, and one policeman came over to speak just to me. And instead of telling me about the regulations that I needed to know about using the trains, he instead asked me a question. Do you know David Beckham? To which I could answer yes, at least in the broadest sense. I don't know him personally, of course. I don't really know him, but I'm very grateful to him because with that answer of yes, I know David Beckham, I was allowed to move further along the platform and wait for the next train to go and join Gabriela. I don't think I would have had a large punishment for not understanding the timing of the trains, but the point, of course, is that we really need to know the person of Jesus. Personal relationship is not just for a few special ones. Again, it's for every sheep, for you and for me. Now, finally, even in this sheep image, we see that it's not about being in a holy huddle of a sheepfold until heaven. The shepherd that we follow is on a mission. He has sheep of another sheepfold that he would join together with us as one flock. Jesus was the shepherd to the lost sheep of Israel, who he saw as sheep without a shepherd. But his heart was for the Gentiles too, those of every nation and people group. Jesus said, I have sheep that are not of this sheepfold. I must bring them also. They too will listen to my voice, and there shall be one flock and one shepherd. They will listen to Jesus' voice, obey him, and come to follow him. That's his word and an encouragement for our mission. We are joined with Jesus in his purpose. Jesus' ministry was to Jews, Samaritans, and others. This drawing in of sheep from other sheepfolds found a wider fulfillment, though, through the mission of his church, as they fulfilled that call to make followers or disciples of all nations. So how are you and I relating to the sheep of the other flock that Jesus wants to bring in and make one with us? In a literal flock of sheep, this would bring discomfort and take some time. And it does for us too. If we are following the shepherd, though, then we need to accept this as part of our lives. Well, I'm nearly at the end now, but let's take some time before we move on to respond to God. I just encourage you to close your eyes and to put your hands out, palms up, and just have a few moments that we can speak to God and reflect on what he has been saying to each one of us, because he speaks to us. So Jesus, thank you that you indeed do speak to your sheep, that we can hear your voice. Thank you that you've been speaking to us today. Thank you, Jesus, for increasing our understanding through your word today. You are the one who offers abundant life, full life, who opens the eyes of the blind. We look to you and we ask that you'd grow our faith in you. And Jesus, you call us, the ones in this parable, my sheep. We know that you know us and you want us to know you personally. And I ask, Lord, that you would guide each one of us in knowing how we might grow in our knowledge of you and of your voice. And Lord Jesus, we ask as well that you would give us hearts for the other sheep that you are bringing into your flock, those who are sheep without a shepherd. Share your heart with us. Help us to welcome in those that you are drawing. Thank you, Lord Jesus. Amen.
Let us pray. Dear Lord, thank you for being with us and looking after us during this season. Thank you for our family, friends, church family, for food on our plates and a bed to sleep in, things that we can so easily take for granted. Please help us to be grateful. Sorry for those times when we are not thankful, and give us each a heart that seeks after your heart. Amen.
Amen. Dear Lord, we pray for those that are suffering in the world right now. We pray for those in Belarus that are protesting for their rights. May your will be done. We pray for those in Lebanon, both those suffering and those helping. Give them all the strength to carry on. Pray for those in Poland, where there is rising transphobia and homophobia. I pray that your light would shine there, Lord. And we pray for those that are struggling financially at the moment as well. Once again, I pray that your light would shine and that people would be given the strength to carry on. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Dear God, we pray for young people. We pray that those who have received results for GCSEs and A-levels can be at peace with whatever they get, and encourage them to know that there is so much more to a person than what grades they get. We pray for all the young people who are missing their friends and all the activities and hobbies that they would have been doing this summer. Keep them hopeful and joyful, Lord. Bless the people who are going back to school for the first time in months and those who are starting in new schools. We pray that they would be able to enjoy themselves, even with the social distancing. And finally, Lord, we pray that young people with faith have built even stronger relationships with you over this time and not distanced themselves from you. Amen.
Amen. Lord, we pray for the older people around us, family and friends, and especially the feeling of isolation that they may well be experiencing. We also pray for those who are sick or have been in hospital, and we think of Brian Jones and all those who are named in this week's Connect. We ask for your Holy Spirit to intercede on our behalf. And let's end by saying the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
Let us
Thank you, Catherine, Ed, and Will, for leading us in prayer. And thanks, Liz, for leading us in worship. And as we bring this service to a close, here are some final words of blessing. May our love abound more and more in knowledge and depth of insight, so that we may be able to discern what is best and may be pure and blameless until the day of Christ, filled with the fruit of righteousness that comes through Jesus Christ to the glory and praise of God. Amen. Don't forget our Zoom coffee morning happening at 11:30. Have a really good week.